were shorter and less frequent now, and the pace was taking its toll on those around him. He had long since abandoned his vegetarian food regimen in favor of what he later called the Haldeman diet, eating anything and everything his crew could cook or buy. And despite continued use of ultrasound and other gadgetry, Shermer, just like all the others, was hurting.
Ouch.
The last thing that hurts is your leg muscles. Your feet, your knees, your hands, and your butt. Because they all make contact with the bike. And I don't care how good a condition you're in, doing that 20 hours a day is very destructive to your body. And it hurts. I hurt right now.
When Shermer reached the Mississippi just past midnight, his crew staged a small celebration, as they would at every state border. But from a competitive standpoint, there was little to cheer about. It had been 4 hours since John Howard had left Missouri, 17 hours since Lon Haldeman had ridden this bridge. And far back down the road, John Marino had slowed to 8 miles per hour.
Yesterday's engines didn't have to work hard to power the average car. Today's smaller engine
of the second week of the Great American Bike Race. During the preceding night, Lon Haldeman had ridden out of Illinois and made it as far as Indianapolis before stopping for 3 hours of sleep. Now it was early afternoon, and he was in Richmond, very close to the Ohio border. As he made his way through the farm towns and smokestack cities of the Midwest, Haldeman continued to shoot down any and all theories about the need for specialized nutrition in endurance sports. And against all apparent logic, he argued that he was still concerned about whether he could win the race. This despite the fact his biggest physical problem was numbness in the hands. If he was experiencing the kind of pain his pursuers felt, he wasn't letting on. And though rain and headwinds had forced him to admit he would indeed take more than 9 days to reach New York, he crossed into Ohio with the same sense of urgency he had shown in riding sleepless through the first night a long week before. For John Marino, it was a different story. He was all the way back in Missouri, and the race which he had dreamed about for so long had become nothing but a nightmare now.
Place, he was nearly 2 days behind Haldeman. He was about 22 hours behind Shermer in third place, and he had suffered every misfortune imaginable. No one would have thought less of him for dropping out. But pride runs deep sometimes, and he decided that even breaking his previous best time for the cross country was a goal worthy enough to continue enduring for.
When Haldeman left Ohio, there were 10 states behind him and only 5 more to go. But from the beginning, the riders had all said the hills in West Virginia would be the toughest on the map.
Mostly sunny skies await us today. The high today is 75 degrees. Clear skies tonight, overnight low 55. And much of the same thing for Friday.
The weather report sounded good, but this was to be a rough day. The night had been spent in a cold and disorienting Ohio fog. And as New York loomed closer on the map, Haldeman was slowing down. Some of us were mildly surprised to note that he was human, after all.
I'm finding I'm almost going to have to rest because what I found last night is I start dozing off on the downhills and I don't really want to take a spill at 40 miles an hour. So that's why I decided it was better to take a 2-hour break than break my neck. So on the uphills, I can ride those, you know, when I'm sleeping. And I think I have to ride those starting now. For about the next 14 hours is going to be in the mountains.
All right, enjoy the scenery.
Okay.
By now, all of us who were following Haldeman had begun counting the hours to New York. So this was a frustrating day. As the grade got steeper, as Lon and a local companion rode more and more slowly, our projected arrival in New York was moved farther and farther back. And And though Lon hadn't seen the other three racers since the first few hours of the first day, he was asking about them more often now. It goes back to something he had told us even before the start of the race, a mark of his extraordinary decency and sincerity.
We want everybody to finish, I think, first off, and for each of us to do well individually and feel, know in our own hearts that we did our best. And if, as long as I do that, I'll be satisfied.
That's more important than winning.
For me, if I end up coming in there 2 days behind, but with my best effort, I'll just have to live with that.
And if you got there and broke the record, but none of the other three finished, would it feel the same to you?
It wouldn't feel good. I want everybody to finish.
Evening in West Virginia. Almost heaven, they call it, but more important to Haldeman, almost Maryland. While Haldeman had spent his Thursday in the mountains of West Virginia, Michael Shermer was fighting an acid stomach in Indiana.
Michael? Maylock.
Maylock.
This wasn't an entirely new experience for Shermer, but he wouldn't have been interested in the race if he hadn't known he would learn from it. Shermer first took up serious bike riding in 1979, by which time John Howard had already dominated Olympic-style road racing in this country for nearly 10 years. By August of 1982, he was able to train up to 700 miles per week at speeds dictated by a moto pacer. Like Howard, he saw a chance to be on the cutting edge of a new development in endurance sports, and he was determined to leave nothing to chance. And of course, no psychologist would ever ignore the demand for intense mental preparation.
I would say that everybody is going to be physically prepared to a certain level. I mean, you have up to a 100% efficiency physically you can be. All of us will be somewhere between 90 and 100 just because we're training so hard. So really the difference between who wins this race is going to be totally mental.
One of the features of Shermer's scientific approach to the event was a series of sessions with a hypnotherapist.
Slowly. And as your arm goes up, you'll go deeper and deeper into the state of hypnosis.
There's so many experiments that are really interesting where under hypnosis you can control pain, you can learn to control pain, you can change blood pressure and heart rate and breathing rate. And this is well-documented stuff, and it's interesting the powers that you can have over yourself. And it's nothing mystical about it, it's just good, solid mental preparation.
If Shermer had ever worried about his level of hypnotic suggestibility, he might have taken lessons from his dog, Buckwheat.
And on one wall, you see a gigantic screen. Right now, I'd like you to think of an image that you can call on anytime during the race. Your unconscious mind will see that your body is running like a finely tuned machine.
It's a matter of different strokes for different folks. A simple man like Lon Haldeman might not benefit much from hypnosis. Michael Shermer, on the other hand, is convinced it could be of great help to him.
That's good. That was...